This makes me feel good. My session yesterday, I think I had about 10 people. So, much better. No, it was migrating Performance One Concurrent. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What time of day?
1:30? Yeah. Everybody was there pretty much knew how to do it. So, it was good, though. It's a good conversation. Okay, so I'm here to talk about advanced dashboards, and let me get this thing moving forward. I'm Jason Burns. I'm a program manager at Microsoft on the Performance Point team, actually now the Office BI team. So we cover Excel BI features like pivot tables, pivot charts, Excel services, and Performance Point, obviously. Today, I kind of thought long and hard about how I wanted to do this demo, because Microsoft kind of had a demo we've been doing since SharePoint conference in Las Vegas a couple years ago that wasn't really working for me. I'm more of a, let's try and do something fun and kind of interesting with it instead of just dive into cubes. So I put together a quick agenda that I'll just go over real quick. I'm going to do something that I'm just calling fun with scorecards and indicators, because based on, I'm a little obsessive compulsive, and I kind of believe in, you build a scorecard, you have targets, and you know everything works. And in dealing with a lot of customers, especially internal customers, I've found that people don't really use targets a lot. They'll use scorecards as reports, and then you have these indicators that kind of get left on there. So I figured out a way that we can use those for something a little more interesting than a target indicator, and we'll build that. Then I'm going to kind of take a step back and say, you know, what external reports can we hook up? I reached out to some of our people in the field, and they told me that, you know, customer asks are usually, how can I hook up other stuff? How do I make the filter connections? How do I make the dashboard web parts connect up? So we're going to do that. And then finally, I'm actually going to do the hookup of the web parts and all the filters and show you how that works. So then we'll do a little wrap up and some questions. Before we get started, SQL Server Analysis Services, cubes, OLAP, all this kind of, you know, heavy terms and dictionary of stuff, I'm leaving that out today. So if you came here to get a demo on how to build Performance Point from a SQL Server Analysis Services cube, that's not what I'm going to do today. I'm actually going to get rid of the cubes and focus on Excel and SharePoint. So we're going to use SharePoint lists as data sources. We're going to use a couple other tools to get data into our scorecards and our reports, but we're not going to use an actual analysis services cube. Does that disappoint anybody? Good. I've kind of fought this battle a lot. We'll go to customers and talk to them, and either they have no cube or they have a bad cube, and they're like, how can I use this product still? So that's kind of where we're going to go. So who, why, and what? I've kind of focused on this little fakey-bakey scenario with a bunch of movie data that I made up, so it's not real. The names of the movies are real, but the data's not real. And we're focusing on someone that's kind of a whiz at Excel. They're comfortable in SharePoint, and they want to compare movie sales and reviews, and they want to see which movies are making the most money. So we're going to build a dashboard that kind of helps accomplish this goal. They also want to know what viewers think of these movies, so we're going to try and add some detail. And a lot of times I find customers frustrated because they can't get down to detailed information in Performance Point. It only really summarizes stuff, so we're going to try that. And then the data that we're going to get to start with is going to be in two SharePoint lists. We're going to have one list that has the movie review data, and then we're going to have one list that has the sales and theater data. And we're going to kind of bring that stuff together. So what Heidi would like to see is a scorecard that has the top five movie reviews, their sales, and their average review. But what she'd really like to see, I must have missed that slide. Why is that not on there? There should be another slide here that shows Amazon-style indicators. That's what we're going to do with the indicators. So the kind of five-star with half-star increments to show your ratings. So I'll just dive into that, since that slide is missing. The topics for this little section, we're going to create a custom indicator in Dashboard Designer. Has anybody done that before? A couple? OK. You can do some really cool stuff with the indicators. I even did some really blingy GIF, animated GIFs one time. It's kind of funny. We're going to do creating KPI from the SharePoint list. We're going to create the scorecard, and then we're just going to stick it on a dashboard. So let me switch over to this machine. There's my other slide. Now it shows up. Gross sales in millions. An average review with stars. That's what we're going to build. So let me flip over to my server here, which hopefully is all warmed up and happy. OK, so I've got all this content in here, and I'm going to kind of duplicate it. But some of the things I didn't want to build from scratch because they get a little tedious, so I might open some things from time to time. But the data connections is one thing that I'm going to show you how I did that, although I'm not going to build both of them. If you haven't done data connections from SharePoint into Performance Point. I have a few lists here that are in SharePoint. If you go here to the list view in the ribbon, you'll see this export as a data feed icon. Has everybody used that before? Creates these really handy dandy files that you can use to then bring data in Power Pivot anywhere else, right? So I'm leaving these sitting here. We're going to get to those a little later. But these SharePoint lists are where my data sources are. So in Performance Point, if you add a new data source, it's a matter of saying, hey, I want a SharePoint list as my data source. And then you're just going to give it a point to where the server is. In this case, we've got a whole domain kind of built up on this thing. So we're going to say it's intranet.contoso, which you're probably tired of seeing, TechEd. And then I think that's it. And I should get all lists. So I drop that down, and then it'll give me the entire lists on that server to choose from. So the two that I created were, again, the movie review sales and the movie sales details. We'll just start with the sales details. The cache lifetime, if you have the stuff, like maybe you're using a virtual list through BDC and you want to be have you know really fast update, you can just crank this down to zero and it will always query the SharePoint list immediately. We're not going to really do that, but I'll go ahead and change it just for fun. And then I'm not going to set up time because we're not going to do anything with time today, and that's a little tedious. If you have questions, I'll be glad to answer time questions a little later. So we'll just call this movie sales info, and we'll give it a display folder, get live demo, and now we have our data source. So the KPI that we're going to create, I'm going to create after the indicator, so I can kind of show you that first. But I'm not going to go through the entire indicator part because that'll kind of waste your time. But I will build the beginning of it. So when you create a new indicator, what we give you is a whole bunch of choices. Different. The centered ones are when you're kind of center weighting things, and then you can use the standard types if you want to do, you know, greater is better or least is better. We're going to go blank. It's going to ask me how many bands that I want. I'm going to use standard because so we're doing, you know, what the average review is. We definitely want higher is better. And then I'm going to choose 7 as the amount of bands because that works out to how many images I really need to display. And I've just created pings here, just standard PNG files that you can kind of create with any image editing program. So what you'll see in here is here are your levels that you're indicating with your bands and the display names if you're going to use those. And then it's going to ask for an image and then a text color and a background color. For what we're doing, the only thing that really comes into play is the image. But if you saw the bombed TechEd demo yesterday, the strategy map colors that you saw are by setting these background colors. You can then link to Visio, and Visio will pick up the color from the indicator. So you can do some cool stuff there, too, if you're trying to do regional stuff or maybe a factory map or something like that, and you want to use colors for zones. So no data, I usually just leave alone. You can have an image if you want to have, like, a you know an X or a circle with a line through it or something if you haven't had actual data. And then for the rest of these, I should be able to double-click and get a browser. And on my desktop, I have a little folder that I just stuck them in. And I have my images for my indicators. So since we're on level 1, the worst, that's going to be half star. And then we're going to go to 1 star. And again, I'm not going to make you watch that. I have all this already done. I'll show you the finished one, which is right here. So, OK. So this is what the completed indicator looks like. You can see that all the bands match up. And then, you know, you don't have to do anything special in properties. You can set that if you need to, but it's not important to make it actually work. And then we need to create a KPI that we actually want to attach this thing to and use it. So my movie sales data I have, but I actually get my review data from the different lists. So let's bring that list in real quick. Movie review details. So now I have 2 SharePoint lists that are in here, and I need to create a KPI to bring those things together into the same scorecard and use my indicator. So we're going to create a new KPI, and now I'm just going to use a blank. And then we're going to need actually 2 actuals and a target, but we're really only going to show 1 of the actuals. You still need the second one to compare to. So I'm going to create a second one. We're going to call 1 just gross for the sales. And then we'll call the other one, you know, the average for the review rating. And then we'll actually call the target rating because that's what we're going to show on the scorecard. And then you can map these right to your SharePoint data sources that we have. So this one was gross, so we're going to get it from the sales info and grab out the gross values. And then our average is coming from the other list, so we'll pull it from it, like so. And if you haven't used KPI mappings against non-AS data sources, the aggregate members by option is down there, but it actually is always going to be some if you're not using AS. You can use other defaults if you're using analysis services, but for SharePoint lists or Excel workbooks, Excel services, it's always going to be some. So we're going to grab the rating. And then for our KPI target, we're going to say we want to set it. We're increasing is better is right. And we're going to change this to band by numeric value of actual. So what that's saying is the banding that we set up on that indicator is going to map directly to a number, which will be the average of that review that we're pulling in. So we'll pull our custom indicator we created in. And was that the right one? Good. Yep, that's the right one. Okay, so now we have all these bands and they're all completely wrong. So what we need to do is come down here and go, this is a little boring. 3, 2, 1, actually it was 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We're telling them what we want these things to line up to. So 0 is the worst. You won't even have a star at all for 0. If we get 1 through 10, you'll get these other indicators. So it is right, isn't it? That is not right. I'm sorry, I'm on my soda indicator. So the right is 5. The best is 5. So we're going to put 6 here. And then we'll go with 5 stars for the 5 stars, and then 4.5. This gets really tedious, by the way, because it always tries to figure out what you want underneath it and changes it for you. Did I miss 4? Thank you. I'm trying to make mistakes. It's on purpose. Yeah, it is a test, and I'm failing miserably. But you guys get to have fun at my expense, so it works out, right? And that should work. Okay, so that's how you set that KPI up. And now we want to put it on a scorecard, so we have to give that a name. We'll call it movie performance, because that's super fun. And then we'll create just a really simple scorecard and choose blank since we're not using analysis services. And at this point, we can just kind of drag and drop our stuff on there. So our KPI gets dragged on the top when it decides to come up. Okay, so we take our KPI and we drag it onto here. And then we'll come down here now that we have a data source. We'll use the sales info because it has all the movie names. And now for dimension, I can just take movie and drag it over here. We'll tell it we want to select all of them, which you'll notice doesn't meet the requirement of wanting top 5. We'll get to that in a little bit. And when I update this, we should have gross and then the average and then the rating showing way the wrong number because we did not change this. This is the trick, right? We wanted the target comparing to the actual of the average. So let's change that and update the scorecard again. And it should look a lot more interesting. Should look a lot. Why is it not showing average? No, that's the target. The target by default does normalize value. It should be comparing it to. Did I? Maybe were you? I'll tell you what we'll do. I'm going to go to my one that I actually did that works and show you that one. Okay, this is the right KPI. So let's see what's different. We have gross, we have rating. That, yeah, that is interesting. Okay, I'll show you what it looks like when it's deployed to SharePoint. How about that? Okay, so I have a whole bunch of dashboard content in here. And one that I have is called just Top Performers, Top 5 Movies. And I'm actually letting the cat out of the bag and showing you the whole thing. But here's where you see all these targets. Now, I have a bunch of movie data. I want to have a lot extra, and I only have review data for kind of the top 10 movies, so that's why you're seeing these holes in the review. We're going to get rid of all of those here in a second. Then we're going to add in the other reports in here. So our scorecard is just that simple scorecard, right? And with our indicators, and it's not very interesting. We want to do something a little more fun with this report. So let me kind of switch back over, and we're going to talk about the reports you can add. So that was fun. I did add a few resources in here if you get the deck later for creating a KPI indicator and learning about scorecards, but I'm assuming you guys probably know that stuff. Using external reports with PPS dashboards. So we have a lot of other reporting options for people to use when you can't use the analytic grid and chart features that are kind of tethered to AS. I'm going to show you what those options are. We're going to add an Excel services report. We're going to add a reporting services report. I'm going to add a web report, just a custom web report, and show you how to build one with no coding. And we'll kind of put all that together in the demo. So what other reports can you use in Performance Point? There's Excel services. There's ProClarity Analytics for any of you guys that use the old PAS reports still. There's reporting services reports. There are Visio strategy maps, which you probably saw yesterday in BI Power Hour, and then web page reports. And I kind of put an asterisk beside that because you can really do anything with the web page report. We can allow you to pass parameters to a web control, basically a web part that has anything in it. And that's pretty easy. So the Excel report that I'm going to show you I think is kind of fun. There's a guy that is an MVP named Perna Dugarella. I've actually talked to him a little bit. He's a really cool guy. And he built this on his website using Excel and VBA, which was kind of a really cool scorecard that you could click, and then it would give you kind of the breakdown style Amazon review. And I thought it would be really fun to show how we could do that with Performance Point with an Excel services report. So we're going to do that. I thought this part could be our scorecard with our 5-star indicators that we did. And then this part could be an Excel services report. So let's do that. Have you guys used Excel services a lot to report with Performance Point? Connect it up. It's pretty handy to get the kind of custom look that you want. So here's the report that we're going to build, if you actually see it. And I have in Excel services this document, and I'll just kind of open up the workbook real quick and show you what it looks like so you can see that I'm not making it up. Documents. And that blog, the blog that I linked there, the entire blog is just full of these really cool workbooks that he's figured out ways to animate and chart and graph just about anything you can imagine. So I believe it is this one. Yeah, this is the workbook. So let's open it up in Excel real quick. And I'll show you. This chart type looks unusual. It's actually just a bar chart. There's nothing special about it. I've just taken one series and kind of mapped it directly to a fixed value so we would get that max out. And the other series is pulling the data from a pivot table. And then I set the overlap so one is just on top of the other so you get that look. So this is the report. You can see it's actually just two series on a regular chart. And I just duplicated the max of the ratings and then created another table so I could quickly put this together. And then I made this a zone called review summary so we could then put it in Performance Point. And to do that, I'm going to close that because this VM's a little slow. To do that, it's actually pretty simple. In Performance Point, you come here and you say you want to create a new report, and you say I want an Excel services report, and then you just point it to where that report is. So in this case, it's already tried to populate something that's not where we're at. So it's actually in TechEd. And then there's a document library called Documents. And then it's going to give me all of the workbooks that are in there. And that one was Movie Review Data. And then it's going to give you a drop-down for the item name. So this can be any chart or pivot table or anything in the workbook. Or you can simply just select a range of cells and say, that's the range I want. And it'll pick it up. It's called Review Summary. You notice there's a parameter in here. Also in that workbook, I didn't show you that, but that's pretty important. I set aside the top cell, I put a report filter on the pivot table, and then I selected the cell that you would modify this filter with and gave it a name also. So you see it's called movie parm for parameter. And that's what we're going to pass things into from our scorecard to get this report to update when you actually use it in performance point. So that's kind of a key point there. So we have everything we need to set it up. You can come here and you can preview it if you want, and it'll show what it looks like. It's pretty simple. Let's save this guy as review summary. I'm going to switch over to the scorecard that I know works very well since I totally baked that one out. So let's just get rid of these. And in our workspace, or in SharePoint, we have movie performance scorecard. So this should be our working scorecard that has the million that we showed. What all I've done there to get that is set the formatting in here to say I want to do a multiplier of 00001. So that brings it down to show it in millions. And then I told it I want space M to always show up after the value. And that gets you that look if you want to do thousands or millions or whatever. So with that scorecard, I need to create a quick dashboard that we can connect this report to. I'm not going to do the connections yet. I'm just going to stick this stuff on there and build the other two reports, and then we'll do the connections all at once. So let's take our scorecard and stick it on here. And then our report review summary. And that's actually all there is to getting the Excel report on there. Of course, again, it's not connected, but let's build the other two real quick before we connect everything up, because I'm actually going to totally mess it up for fun. Okay, so adding a reporting services report. I've got the review data, and we want to show, when you click a movie in the scorecard, we want to show the review data that's related to that particular movie. So in my SharePoint server, I've also got a reporting services report in here that we can use. And I think it's just in, let's go to all site content here. Reports, maybe. Oh. What's that? Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. So let's go in here. I've got a report here called Movie Review Detail. And if we look at the editor, how this is set up, I've got SharePoint server integrated mode. And if you look, I've got report server, which is the default name of report server on a SharePoint site. And then I've just told it where I uploaded this particular report. So if we were to go into our document library, we should see that, actually, was it not documents? Documents, reports. Oh, it's in the root site, that's why. Okay. I had to do it in the report site. There's a review, the root site, so documents. So here you see that we have this, and we could open it up in Report Designer and edit it. Creating a report in Report Designer is a little tricky, as opposed to just connecting it to a SQL Server database or an AS source, because some of the things act a little different and the data connection is a little strange. So I wanted to open this up and just kind of show you that. You can't do filters the same way. You kind of have to filter it a little differently to get this part to work. So let me just show you around Report Builder really quick. Everything is running in Hyper-V, so it's a little slow. A per string web part? Oh, query string. Absolutely. Yeah. That's the next one we're going to do. I'll show you that one too. Okay. So still has not loaded Report Builder. The query string thing, that's the web report that I discussed. That's exactly what we do. So I kind of put together a really quick report to show movie posters. It's basically a SharePoint list. And then we're going to use a query string to pass the parameter to that report. Okay, Report Builder finally came up. So this is a really simple report. If you look, I also have a parameter here for movie that's just going to be the title. And then you have to set the data source specifically. We kind of went over this yesterday, which is kind of interesting that you have to do it. You know, data sources in different places, but this is the data source that you have to create for a SharePoint connection. And you have to build a really kind of funky query to get it to work. And I don't see that now. Data sets, yeah, that's right. Okay. Okay, yeah. You have to kind of do a little funky XML query to get the stuff in. Huh? XAML. Yeah, XAML. It's still XML. Yeah, I see everything as XML when it's formatted that way. Been knowing this too long. Okay, so this query, I actually copied it directly from TechNet. There's a good article on there for how to do it. It was honestly the first time I ever used reporting services, and I did it in a few minutes, so I wouldn't be too intimidated by it, but it took a little bit of looking around to figure out how to make it work. It's not as straightforward. So with that report on there, we can come in here into the designer and our dashboard and just get that guy on there. And I'm just going to put it below this one. And then the last report, I'm not going to switch back to the, well, I can just to show you the pictures because they're pretty. There's a few resources for this one, too. Adding a web report. So I thought it'd be really cool to show the movie poster associated with the movie when you click it in the scorecard. So what I did is I uploaded all of the images into an image library, a document library, and then I created a SharePoint list that used image type to just put the URL to each of the images in it. So if you were to look in this list, it's just a SharePoint list. It's just actually showing poster images. And I included one called blank because when I, what's that? Oh, sorry about that. Keep forgetting.
The last day.
Yeah. It is. It is. So I have these, you're seeing pictures, but this is just the all items view in a SharePoint list because the only thing that's being shown is the single field, which is set to image. So it's automatically going to show the images. And I added this one that's blank because when I load the dashboard, I don't want it showing a movie because you haven't selected anything. So I went into SharePoint Designer, which everybody loves, right? Huh? Hey, you can actually do some really cool stuff easily. And I wanted to do a web report without having to break into code, right? So I thought it would be fun to use SharePoint Designer for that. So I have this report on here that I'm just going to build again if I have to open a site first. Okay. Let's see. So I'm going to create a list view in SharePoint Designer, and then just attach a parameter to it. That's all. So let's go to Site Pages, and we'll just create a new one. New, I just want a plain page. Okay. And we'll call it posters. And then in the data sources, since I'm connected to this light, yes, I want to edit, even though I'm safe mode. I'm going to come down here and say I want to insert a data view, and then I'm going to choose the list that I have. So I had two that related to posters. This is the one that I want. And it's going to show everything, but obviously when we connect it to a dashboard, we don't want to show everything, and we also don't want them to be this big. So we're going to resize these, and since it's a view, it'll resize all of them. And we actually wanted to resize those. Let's do it this way. So it stays scaled correctly. We'll say we don't want them any wider than 250. Did I not? Glad you guys are here. Okay. Keep aspect ratio, very important. Okay, and then I want to filter. So we're going to give it what we want to pass to it, which in this case is the title, I think, or is the movie. Yes, yeah, movie in this list. Title is actually just not being used. And then we're going to give it a parameter, and we're going to create a new one. When you do the web report, you have to always use the same query string name, and it's called an endpoint URL. So we'll just call this movie title, and then we're going to say we want to use the query string an endpoint URL, and then I'm going to say the default value is blank, so it always pulls up that blank image that I have in that list. And once we do that, we can save this guy, and we have all we need to create our web report in PPS. So I can come here, say I want a new report. I'll say that I want a web page report. And then I give it this URL, which let's actually just browse to it and copy it so we know it works for sure. Site pages, I call it posters.aspx, right? So know where it's at. Tech ed type pages. What? Ah, thank you. There we go. So now we have nothing because we set it to always default to blank. That's all we actually need in here. So we're going to copy that into Performance Point and paste it if it's really nice. This image has been killing me. We were working on the BI Power demo up to the very last minute yesterday, and we had SharePoint up and PPS up and Visual Studio up and everything, and it was just a total nightmare. Yeah, it's running on Hyper-V. We have a demo image that was created for us that I think is going to be made public pretty soon. That has everything, and it has, you know, all the Power Pivot bits set up, and all the secure store set up, and all the unattended service account stuff set up. So you can actually install it in a modular way. So you install the base image, and then you can install content packs on top of that that light up all the different things. So if you want to play with things and not have to build an environment, it's really, really handy. So we have that, and we'll call that poster report. We'll put that in this folder too. Live demo, and that's it. That's all the stuff that we actually wanted to put on the dashboard. So we can come back to our dashboard. Missed it, and we can drag this web report. Has anyone done this before? I'm just curious. The web report, you have? Then why'd you ask? You weren't sure? Oh, from a SharePoint. Okay. Gotcha. All right, so now we have a dashboard. And we'll just call this also movie performance dashboard. And if we were to publish this guy out, everything will be there, but of course nothing is connected, right? And we want everything to be connected. But let's just view it and make sure everything's there. I'll switch over and kind of go through this last thing, because this is where I throw everything off. Okay, so using web reports, that's what we just went through. Here are some URLs that you can get to in the deck that kind of give you more information on that. So interactivity with filters and web part connections. The overall thing that I kind of wanted to show is just how this stuff, you know, really connects up in case you haven't done it. So here's the four parts that we've built. And obviously, we want our scorecard to emit values to the other three reports where they update. But it'd also be cool to have a filter that updates everything, right? But we use a SharePoint list, and we didn't have AS, so it's going to be really hard to connect up some kind of model. So the web parts are, you know, SharePoint pages. The dashboard is SharePoint pages. The reports, scorecards, filters are all web parts. They all use the common framework, so we can pass everything around. The connections can be made and edited in Dashboard Designer, or in the browser, or in SharePoint Designer. I put a big warning in here for you guys that I gave the other crew yesterday. If you come and start doing these, you know, really interesting type of dashboards and connecting stuff up outside of Dashboard Designer, do not redeploy it from Designer, because everything that you create will be gone. The way that we publish things, it always will overwrite the ASPX, and if you modify it outside of Designer, then we don't know about those changes in Designer. So just a good tip. So now is where we're going to take the left turn. I guess you guys have heard of Power Pivot, right? Everybody's talking about Power Pivot this week? It was right, left turn, right turn. Okay. Okay. So Power Pivot. That was the default image. Give me a break. Okay. So what I thought would be cool is let's take the two SharePoint lists and let's bring them into Power Pivot, make a really quick model around them, and then we can have some filters to slice this dashboard by some more interesting things. So I created a workbook with some other, I'm just going to close this, some other things that we could use to connect. Some other things that we can use to connect. So I created a really quick date dimension because I only created 2 weeks worth of data. I created a movie dimension so we would have some stuff like, you know, what studio it is and what genre the movie is. And then I added one for the rating system too if we wanted to do kind of pick your rating by name. So in Power Pivot, I already have this workbook completed and I'm not going to make you sit here and watch me try and drag connections. So let me just open that workbook. So it is not already open. Documents. I called it Movie Data Model. This is where those SharePoint feed files come in that I was talking about earlier. The way that I actually brought the list in is from SharePoint, I would say that I wanted to export the list as a data feed, did it for both of those lists, that created the two files that I was talking about on my desktop right here. And then in Performance Point, you can say I want a, in Power Pivot, let's open the Power Pivot window. You can very quickly point this saying that I want to get my data from a data feed, point it to one of those files, and it will bring all of that data in. And the connection is actually refreshable. Even though you're connecting to that feed file later, if you want to refresh your workbook, the data's changed. In SharePoint, you just, you know, either have the server set to auto-refresh it or you refresh the workbook if you're using it in the client. So I brought in my details, the sales details. I brought in the review details data. And then I connected my movies dimension to the title of the movie in both of these. And then that's actually all I think I used. The date dimension, I did connect the date up so we could get to this weekend thing. I thought it would be really interesting to make it where you could filter the scorecard by whether it was a weekend or not and see the data, see the difference in the data. So that's the workbook that we're using to create the connection in Performance Point. Is pretty simple. I say that I want to use analysis services, even though I'm not. And I'm going to open this other one to show you the connection string. We'll see, new AS source, because I'm not actually going to use it. In our data connections, I have Power Pivot data source right here. And this is what you do. Provider equals MS OLAP, semicolon data source equals, and the URL to the workbook. And assuming that you have the server bits, you know, set up in SharePoint, that's all it takes. We treat it like an AS cube, just like anything else. So let's look at the scorecard or the KPI. I recreated that KPI using that data source. And I think I called it movie, just performance. I think this is the one. So if you look, now I'm just using sum of gross from the Power Pivot data, and I'm using average rating from the Power Pivot data. And I actually pulled that in there too, even though it wasn't necessary. And I have my correctly banded indicator. And then I also have the scorecard that I built, but I'm going to show you something a little fun there too. We'll just rebuild that scorecard. So now that I have my data in Power Pivot, again, same data, same SharePoint data, we've just kind of augmented a little bit. I'm going to say blank scorecard again. We're going to drag that KPI in here, and I'll stick it here. And then now, if you notice, I have Power Pivot data source here. I can come to my dimensions, which are still loading, and say I want movies to be, you know, the top of this, right? And I want to select all of the movies. That's not what I wanted. I wanted title of the movie. We'll just do it on the right side. If you notice the different sides light up, you can completely rearrange the scorecard any way you want. I'm going to say I want to auto-select the members, all of the children. And what you'll see when we update this is the entire list. But we wanted the top five, right? So since this is Power Pivot, which is in essence analysis services, I wrote this handy-dandy query, which is very, very simple. It's just a top count query in MDX. So we'll paste that in. I'm going to delete this that we just dragged in, and we're going to say we want to use a set formula custom. That's going to pop up. I type in my query, and now when I update, I'll always have the top five. You could. Mm-hmm. Yep. You could have done actually quite a few different ways, but I thought it would be interesting so you can just use MDX directly against it like AS. There's usually some confusion about that. So here's my scorecard, and now we want to put that on the dashboard and hook everything up because I can also use filters now. So let's do that real quick. Performance point, we'll create a filter, and I'm going to say we want a member selection filter. And we'll come down here to our PPS data source for Power Pivot. And I want to filter this now on my dimension that was weekend, so we can say yes or no if it was weekend or not. The members, you can select them. I'll just manually select them here. And we'll say next. And I'm just going to use a list. Actually, let's go back and say that we do want a default member. Default will be all. So when you view this thing, straight up, it's going to show all of the sales, and then you can filter it differently if you want to. Just in a list is fine. That creates the simple filter. We'll call this weekend filter. And now where's our dashboard? Our dashboard is right here. I'm going to just take all the stuff that we created off. Actually, just the scorecard's all we need to take off. And we'll put the new scorecard that we have on there. Which, what did I call that? New scorecard. PP scorecard. Okay. There is my dashboard. Okay. Scorecards. PP scorecard. Okay. And then we want to put our filter just above that. So we'll come down here and we'll drag the weekend filter up. But nothing is connected. So now we want to connect everything. So the member unique name, since we're using actual AS in the scorecard and the filter, we're going to use the member unique name dragged on the scorecard to connect up that filter and filter that scorecard. But once we go to these other reports that we want to connect up, we're not really using MDX anymore. It's not going to have a member unique name. So we're just going to grab the row display values from the scorecard. So KPI display value to review summary. That's our Excel services report. We want to make sure that it's connected to our movie parameter. We want to do the same thing again for our reporting services report. Connects to movie. That's correct. And then one more time for our poster report, which is going to connect to the URL. And then that's it. Everything should be connected. So let's deploy it to SharePoint, see what happens. Cross fingers. Okay, so we have our report that's showing the average reviews for all of the movies because we haven't selected anything. Our movie review detail is showing nothing at the moment, and then our poster is showing the blank poster. These things are all sized funky. I'll switch to the other one. If we drop this down, we should see everything update. So our sales should slice. The reviews should be the same, obviously. If we go to yes, let's see if it updates again. So 169 to 275. And I can go back to all. So we have an actual filtering scorecard that's connected to these reports. If I click a movie title, I didn't connect that. That doesn't work. So the movie title, I did connect that. PP scorecard. Let's look at this KPI display value member. I can't see the rest of this thing. I'm switching over to this one. Let's deploy this guy. Same report. I've done a little bit of sizing and stuff. We should get, my filters are not working. One second to close this mess here. Okay, so in SharePoint, our performance point, we have a whole bunch of stuff. Movie Performance AS is our scorecard, and then top box office performers is the one that I actually meant to do. Let's deploy this one to SharePoint. Promise it will work. Okay. So everything is the same from the layout that you saw, but now when we make these connections, you should see our Fast and the Furious poster displays, our review ratings for the Fast and the Furious display, and this Excel services report that we created will filter by the movie that you select. So Insidious actually doesn't have any in the data, but Rio does. So it's pretty cool, right? You can create stuff that's a little more interesting than just the analytic grids and charts. But one thing that actually is cool is now that we have this data source in Power Pivot, is I can use the analytic grid and charts again that you wouldn't have been able to use otherwise. So if I come in here and say I want to create a new report with a analytic chart using this Power Pivot data source, that lights back up. You'll find a little bit of limitations in, you know, drill capabilities because Power Pivot doesn't have those things lit up yet to have fully formed hierarchies like that. So gets a little tricky, but if I grab sum of gross on the series and we do, let's say, movie studio on the bottom axis, then I can create my reports, same type of thing, you know, switch to universal, I can change it to a different report type if I want, any of that kind of stuff. Actually, that's the same thing. Report type. There we go, pie chart. Let me switch back over to my deck real quick. So that's Power Pivot as a data source. Adding the filter to scorecard, I didn't switch through my slides here, so got forward. These are a bunch of resources that you can use if you are having trouble setting up those Power Pivot data connections or creating filters or anything like that. As far as performance point goes, that's really what I have for showing connecting stuff, but I, you know, would like to kind of address stuff that you guys have been wanting to do with advanced dashboard capabilities. So is there any kind of things you guys have been wanting to do you haven't been able to do so far with Performance Point? Types of reports that you want to connect up, types of things that you want to do from an interactivity perspective? No? Okay. Well, that went way faster than I expected. I would love to take questions and try and help with any Performance Point stuff that you have. Yes, yes.
Not really formulating this question too well, but how about like business intelligence models, like statistical predictions and things like that? Have people integrated an interface in Performance Point to that kind of stuff? You know what I mean? Like data mining.
Uh-huh.
And does that actually lend itself to Performance Point UIs, kind of?
Well, I mean, it depends what you want to do with it. I mean, the data, absolutely, because that's kind of the bread and butter of our report types is the deep analytic reports with a lot of, you know, complex data models. That's kind of where we shine. Yeah, analysis services, you know, I specifically didn't want to show analysis services because people's eyes kind of glaze over usually when we show it, but that is actually one of the entire strengths of the product is our connectivity analysis services, and we've improved that a lot with 2010 with capabilities to do more intelligent, you know, dynamic periods for time reporting type of things, and understanding the model in the data source when you're creating the scorecards to have the ability to, you know, you create a scorecard on the data and you can completely expand it and drill into it. According to the data model without having to pre-configure all that kind of stuff.
Thanks.
So, absolutely. Yes?
Do you have these examples somewhere
like available to us? I will clean them up and put them on the blog this week, the Performance Point blog. If you haven't seen that, it's blogs.msdn.com/performancepoint. That's the one. Yeah. Yes? That was the 10-man session yesterday. So to move these things into production, once you create this, you know, assuming that your data sources are not moving also, it's just a matter of save the workspace, import it to Dashboard Designer connected to the new server, and redeploy it, and you're good. If your servers, data source servers are changing, you might have to change some URLs or connection strings here and there to pass it along, but it's a very, I mean, I'd be glad to show it to you. That's really easy. Yes?
If you have a performance on the filters, uh-huh. can you use a save like
SharePoint web object? So when they come back, the context is the same?
Yeah.
Not currently, no. Anyone else? Yeah?
That was the 2010 migration.
Okay.
So
that actually, I used a lot of yesterday's session to cover that. The migration to 2010 is really a SharePoint installation, is the migration, right? Because before there was the monitoring server standalone, and now it's a SharePoint integrated service. So if you just want to upgrade the box to SharePoint 2010, it actually is a one-click kind of thing. We'll migrate all of your content from the SQL Server database that PPS uses into web parts, into list items, into SharePoint. We'll map the security roles, all that kind of stuff automatically in the upgrade process. If you're going to move it to another server, there's another method you can do by going to the new server in Central Admin and saying that I want to import content from a 2007 server, and it will do the same. You need to have all the creds on the server, obviously, but we'll bring in your SQL Server content database, map everything into items, and set the security up. It's a pretty painless process. The only thing about it to keep in mind is if you have a lot of stuff, when we bring that stuff into 2010, it's kind of just going to be a big list of stuff. So you're going to have to do a little bit of kind of reorganizing things, how you want to see your dashboard designer. It'd be a little unmanageable. We try to break everything out into reports and data sources and KPIs and indicators and filters and all that. So they're more organized that way first, and then your subfolder hierarchy second. So that's one thing to keep an eye on. Anything else? Yes?
A lot of this seems to be based on static data sources like cubes and Excel Power Pivot. Mm-hmm. Is there a way to get access to your standard relational databases? Pulling that data into
yeah. Absolutely. I mean, there are several ways you can do that. I mean, you can connect directly to SQL Server as a data source. You can also use virtual lists with the business data connectivity stuff and just connect it to whatever you want and then consume a SharePoint list that way. If that's what you want to do, both those options work equally as well. I think the BDC is actually a little more flexible. Yes? No? Yes? Say that again.
Waterfall analysis sliders. We have such components available when you use Power Pivot as a backend.
Analysis sliders?
Yeah, what if analysis.
Oh, what if analysis.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's, I mean, for performance point, there's no specific support for the what if analysis features.
And even if you use WLAP cubes, even if you use analysis services, WLAP cubes, you don't have.
No, we can consume the data. We just don't have any functionality to specifically interact with that capability. If the data is there, we can definitely report on it.
Okay.
Yes?
For the external list, the export data feed still helps you?
The export data feed for, you mean from SharePoint list? I'm not sure how that works with, when you're talking about if you use it like for a
BCS.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you know that, Alan? If that works? I don't know. If you create a virtual list, can you still use the export to data feed to suck it into Power Pivot? I assume that's what you meant, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure, but come get my card and send me that question. I'll get you an answer for sure. There's still quite a few. You guys must either like me or have a lot of questions that you're not asking.
Versus native mode on a separate like server.
Well, I mean, I think it depends on the workload that you're trying to, you know, accomplish with the server. If it's a heavy-duty reporting server, then you want it to be standalone. If it's something that's pretty light usage, then it's probably okay to kind of tag it along with.
Like, I'm not missing anything if I keep it in native mode, but I want to use reports in performance.
That's not entirely true. There are some limitations depending on the security model that you check. And when you're using the integrated mode, which it's using when it's installed on the same server, it is limited in functionality. I don't remember off the top of my head what those limitations are, but I remember specifically when I was doing my little experiment with that report, I got quite a few messages in Report Designer that, you know, because you're in integrated mode, you can't do this, you can't do that. I think it was mostly around the report filter stuff. Why did you choose to do that?
For that very reason.
For that, okay.
And, you know, you use the one that you need, and it's a very capable box, so we can get away with that, and it's standalone, it's not virtual. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes? Hold on 1 second, I can't hear. Right? So you can't just put them there, but if you were, when I created the scorecards, if you were to choose the analysis services as the type of scorecard, it'll actually surface all those KPIs, and you can just check them and say, I want to make them PPS KPIs. So it won't technically be the same KPI, but it will duplicate it into a performance point KPI.
But you wouldn't have to redefine the thresholds.
Correct, correct. It will suck all that through. Oh, okay. Yeah. This is my favorite part, so fire away if you still have any. Okay.
How do companies manage the target value versus the KPI? If you have a warehouse, they make that a fact table in the warehouse?
You know, you'd be surprised. More often than not, I see targets coming out of Excel workbooks. Yeah. More often than not, there's a heavy administrative process that establishes the targets. But they never seem to make it back into the data process to formalize that anywhere. So they usually get brought in that way. I've seen it often done in SharePoint lists also. There was a demo that we did, I think it was New Orleans was the last one, where targets were being set in a web part in a form that wrote them back to a workbook that updated the scorecard. So like in this scenario, a salesperson would need to adjust their, you know, targets, and they were actually allowing dynamic, you know, adjustment of the targets. You can absolutely, you know, put them anywhere, but it seems that from administrative perspective, I usually see them in something less formal for the targets.
Yep.
Anyone else?
No?
Okay. Well, one of our testers wrote an awesome book. I linked it in the latest blog on Performance Point, actually. If you look there, it's I can't remember the name off the top of my head, Bright Orange Book, Sam's Publishing. But it's just an all up, you know, getting started in Performance Point services. They have it out there? Yeah. Yeah, Kevin Beto's one of. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Sure, absolutely.
Thank you.